Yesterday we were discussing reabsorption, the second phase of urine formation. So reabsorption of important substances mein aata hai, reabsorption of sodium, reabsorption of water, reabsorption of amino acids, reabsorption of bicarbonate ion. So starting from the reabsorption of sodium, how sodium is reabsorbed from the filtrate into the blood. So sodium, when it is in the filtrate from the glomerular filtrate, 99% of the sodium is reabsorbed. 2/3 of it is reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubule and remaining 1/3 in the other segments, except the descending limb of loop of Henle and collecting duct. So in other segments, the reabsorption is 1/3, and in the proximal convoluted tubule, it is 2/3. 99% of the sodium is reabsorbed. The sodium reabsorption, it occurs in 3 steps. Transport of sodium from the lumen. Lumen means it is the tubular lumen. Renal tubules ka jo lumen hai, the tubular portion of the nephron ke andar, jo andar tubule hai, jahan pe filtrate pada hua hai. So from that lumen into the tubular epithelial cell. Yesterday we talked about the transcellular and paracellular transportation of substances. So it is the transcellular transportation because the transport of the sodium occurs from the lumen into the epithelial cell, then from the epithelial cell to the interstitial fluid, and then from the interstitial fluid to the blood. This is the structure. This is tubular lumen. Tubular lumen may, for example, this is sodium. So the sodium is transported from the lumen into the cell, then from the cell into the interstitial fluid. This is the transportation from the cell into the interstitial fluid, either for directly into the medullary interstitial fluid or the interstitial fluid that is present in between the two adjacent cells. So this is the same transportation that the interstitial fluid is also present between the intercellular spaces or the junction between the two cells. The transportation from the cell into the interstitial fluid and then from the interstitial fluid into the capillary. So the sodium transportation occur in 3 steps. First, from the lumen to the cell, from the cell to the interstitial fluid, and from the interstitial fluid to the capillary. So the first is, that is the transportation from the lumen of the renal tubules into the tubular epithelial cell. So this is actually active transportation. Sodium is reabsorbed actively, and active transportation of sodium ions from the lumen into the tubular cell occur by 2 ways. One is in exchange for hydrogen ion by antipode system. So there are two types of systems. One is known as antipode and the other one is known as symport. Antipode system means the movement of the ions are in opposite direction. For example, sodium is transporting from the lumen into the cell. So the in expense of this, hydrogen ion will move from the cell into the lumen. This is known as antipode system, or it is also known as counterpode system. The movement of ions across the membrane is in opposite direction. So the first is, the first transportation is in exchange for hydrogen ion, and this is through antipode system, which is also known as sodium counterpode protein. The pump or the port that is present in the membrane, that is sodium counterpore protein in the proximal convoluted tubule, because 2/3 of the transportation is taking place in the proximal convoluted tubule. And the second one is it is transported along with the other substances like glucose and amino acids by the symport. Now, what is symport system? This is sodium co-transport protein that is present in the membrane, and the movement of the molecules are in the same direction, like from the lumen, if sodium is crossing the membrane and entering the cell, and from the cell into the interstitial fluid, and from the interstitial fluid into the capillary or the blood or plasma. So the transportation of the substances, the transportation of the sodium along with other substances in the same direction. This type of transportation or the system is known as symport system. It is believed that some amount of substance, sodium, also diffuses along the electrochemical gradient from the lumen into the tubular cell across the luminal membrane, and the electrochemical gradient is developed by sodium potassium pump. Next is from the cell. Now the sodium has entered the cell, and from the cell, from the tubular cell, it has to move to the interstitial fluid. This is the second step in the transportation of the sodium, when it is pumped outside the cell by the sodium potassium pump, and this pump moves three sodium ions from the cell into the interstitium and two potassium ions from the interstitium to the cell. Three ions will move from the cell to the interstitium, three sodium ions and two potassium ions will move from the interstitium into the cell. The tubular epithelial cells are connected with their neighboring cells by tight junctions at their apical luminal edges. But beyond the tight junction, there are spaces in between those adjoining cells or the adjacent cells. And these spaces are known as lateral intercellular spaces. And these spaces are also fluid with the interstitial. This is also filled with the interstitial fluid, as I have discussed in the diagram, that the interstitium is also present in between the two cells. The interstitium extends to these spaces, so the sodium ion can move to that area, which is also interstitium, and from that interstitium it will move to the capillary. Look at this diagram. This is a filtrate in the tubular lumen. Sodium ion is moving from the lumen into the cell, and from the cell, look at this. This is a sodium potassium pump. Three sodium ions moving to the interstitium, and two potassium ions moving to the cell. This sodium ion will then move from the interstitium into the peritubular capillary, like this. Sodium ion is moving to the peritubular capillary. So these are the three steps. One is the movement of sodium from the lumen to the cell. Okay, in expense of hydrogen. Sodium is moving into the cell and hydrogen is moving out of the cell into the lumen. Then this sodium, when it has entered the cell, it will enter from the cell into the interstitium, and three sodium ion will move into the interstitium, and two potassium ion will move from the interstitium into the cell, and this pump is known as sodium potassium pump. And from this area, then it will move to the peritubular capillaries. So most of the sodium ions are pumped into the lateral intercellular spaces by sodium potassium pump, and the rest of the sodium are pumped into the interstitium by the sodium potassium pump situated at the basal part of the cell membrane. The transport of sodium out of the tubular cell by sodium potassium pump, it decreases the sodium concentration within the cell, and this develops an electrochemical gradient between the lumen and the tubular cell, resulting in the diffusion of the sodium into the cell. When sodium is concentrated here, this sodium will move into the interstitium. So the level of sodium will decrease in this cell. This will form an electrochemical gradient. So the sodium which is present in the filtrate, it can diffuse into the tubular cell because of the concentration gradient, that there is low concentration in this cell and higher concentration in the lumen. So the sodium ion will diffuse from this into the cell, from the lumen into the cell by the electrochemical gradient. And this gradient is developed because of the movement of sodium out of the tubular cell by sodium potassium pump, which decreases the concentration of sodium inside the cell. So this is the movement of ions through the electrochemical gradient between the lumen and the cell, which will result in the diffusion of sodium into the cell. This is sodium reabsorption in the proximal convoluted tubule. Here sodium is high, it will diffuse to the cell. From the cell, this is sodium potassium pump. From the cell, it will move to the interstitial fluid, and from the interstitial fluid it will move to the blood or the peritubular capillaries. So these are the membrane proteins which are involved in the transportation of these sodium, and this is active transportation because ATP is utilized here. Sodium enter from the cell through the cell membrane protein, moving down its electrochemical gradient, and then sodium is pumped out of the basolateral side by sodium potassium ATPase. ATP is utilized here, and this is sodium potassium pump. The third is when sodium is present in the interstitial fluid, so from the interstitial fluid it will move to the peritubular capillaries by concentration gradient. In the distal convoluted tubule, the sodium reabsorption is stimulated by a hormone, aldosterone, which is secreted by the adrenal cortex. As you know that adrenal cortex is responsible for the reabsorption of sodium, and aldosterone that is released from the adrenal cortex, it is responsible for the reabsorption of sodium and water. So from the interstitial fluid, it will move, the sodium ion will enter the capillaries by the concentration gradient and in the proximal tubule. And in the distal convoluted tubule, as you know, the receptors for the aldosterone are present in the distal convoluted tubule, and that is responsible for the reabsorption. This aldosterone is responsible for the reabsorption of sodium from the distal convoluted tubule. So this was all about the reabsorption of sodium from the filtrate into the blood in three steps: from the lumen to the cell, from the cell to the interstitium, and from the interstitium to the capillaries. Next is reabsorption of water. How water is reabsorbed? As you know that whenever there is reabsorption of sodium, there is reabsorption of water also occur with that. So the reabsorption of water occur from the proximal convoluted tubule and distal convoluted tubule, and it also occur in the collecting duct. The first one is reabsorption of water from the proximal convoluted tubule, which is an obligatory water reabsorption. What is obligatory water reabsorption? That the obligatory is, it is secondary to the reabsorption of some other things, like sodium is reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubule, as I have discussed. With that sodium, you know, whenever there is reabsorption of sodium, there is reabsorption of water to maintain the osmotic pressure, to maintain the osmotic equilibrium. So because of the reabsorption of that sodium, water is also reabsorbed. Water is reabsorbed because of the sodium, secondary to the sodium. That's why it is known as obligatory reabsorption. That is the type of water reabsorption in the proximal convoluted tubule, which is secondary or obligatory to the sodium reabsorption. When sodium is reabsorbed from the tubule, the osmotic pressure is decreased there, and it causes the osmosis of water from the renal tube. What is osmosis? That is the movement of water molecule from a region of lower concentration to a region of higher concentration. Concentration means this is the concentration of sodium. When sodium has been moved from the lumen to the cell, to the interstitium, to the blood, the concentration of sodium is increased in the cell, in the peritubular capillaries. So water is more concentrated in the lumen. So to maintain the osmotic equilibrium, to maintain the osmotic pressure, because the osmotic pressure has been decreased, so the water will move secondary to the sodium, and it will move from the lumen to the blood. What is the reabsorption of water from the distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct? That is known as facultative water reabsorption. It is a type of water reabsorption which will occur in the distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct, and that will occur by the activity of antidiuretic hormone. We have discussed the antidiuretic hormone, and the receptor for antidiuretic hormone is present in the distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct. Normally, the distal convoluted tubule is impermeable to water because there are channels. We have discussed aquaporins. Aquaporins are the water channels which are present in the distal convoluted tubule. So normally in normal conditions, those channels are closed and the distal convoluted tubule and collecting ducts are impermeable to water in normal conditions. But when there is presence of ADH, ADH is responsible for the opening of those channels, aquaporins, water channels. When ADH will bind with the receptor that is present on the membrane of distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct, so it will cause the increasing the permeability of those segments to water. So that impermeable membrane become permeable to water, so the water is reabsorbed in the distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct. What is the mechanism of ADH? As we have discussed is it in endocrinology, that the mechanism of action of ADH is through aquaporins. Aquaporins are present in the distal convoluted tubule, and antidiuretic hormone will increase the water reabsorption in the distal convoluted tubule and collecting ducts by stimulating the water channels, and water channels are known as aquaporins. So ADH will combine with the receptor. The receptor for aquaporin is V2 receptors, which are present in the tubular epithelial membrane, and it will activate the adenylyl cyclase, an enzyme that is responsible for the formation of cyclic AMP, which is a second messenger. So this cyclic AMP will activate the aquaporin and it will increase the water reabsorption. So aquaporins, what are aquaporins? These are the membrane proteins which will function as a water channel. So there are 10 types of aquaporins which are identified, and out of those 10, 5 are present in human beings. From those 5, aquaporin 1, 2 and 3 are present in the renal tubules, means these are present in the nephrons. Aquaporin 4 is present in the brain, and aquaporin 5 is found in the salivary gland. From these 1, 2 and 3 aquaporin, aquaporin 2 is the most functional aquaporin, which form the water channel in the renal tubule. This is the movement of water. Water will move from the lumen into the cell, and then from the cell into the interstitial fluid, and from the interstitial fluid into the peritubular capillaries. Look at this one. This is the function of the ADH in the distal convoluted tubule. This receptor is present in the cellular membrane of this epithelial cell. Vasopressin, that will this ADH is present in the blood, as hormones are carried to the target organ by blood. From the blood, it will move to the receptor. It's receptor which is present on the surface of the epithelial cell, and by combining with the receptor, look at this, it will cause the formation of cyclic AMP. You know, this is a second messenger. This second messenger will this is responsible for the signaling of the aquaporins. So aquaporins will get open. This is storage vesicles, aquaporin, water pores. These are moving to the surface, and this is responsible for the opening of water channels. Water channel will open, and water is transported from the lumen to the cell, from the cell to the interstitium, and from the interstitium into the capillaries. So this is the mechanism of the aquaporin through the ADH. Third one is reabsorption of glucose. How glucose is reabsorbed? Now, glucose is, as you know, glucose is completely 100% reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubule in normal physiological conditions. So it is transported by secondary active transport system, that is sodium co-transport mechanism. As we have discussed in the transportation of sodium, that sodium is transported along with other molecules by symport mechanism. So here glucose is transported along with the sodium by this sodium co-transport mechanism. Glucose and sodium, it will bind to a common carrier protein, which is present in the luminal membrane of the tubular epithelium, and then it will enter the cell. So from the lumen, glucose along with the sodium, it will enter the cell. The carrier protein to which sodium and glucose will bind. This protein is known as sodium dependent glucose co-transporter 2. From the cell, then glucose is transported into the medullary interstitium by another carrier protein, and this carrier protein is known as glucose transporter 2. Then from the interstitium, it will enter into the capillary. This is the mechanism. I look at this. This is that carrier protein that is sodium dependent protein. The sodium along with the glucose is transported from the lumen into the cell through this sodium dependent glucose co-transporter. These are the brush bordered cells of the proximal convoluted tubule. This is a tight junction. The tight junctions between the two cells, and these are the spaces, intercellular spaces, which are filled with the interstitium. This interstitium is extending to these spaces. Here, this is glucose, this is sodium. So in the cell, then glucose will move to the interstitium by another protein, which is known as glucose transporter 2 protein. It will move through this carrier protein into the interstitium, and from the interstitium it will move to the blood and sodium. The movement of sodium, as we have discussed, the sodium will move through another pump that is known as sodium potassium ATPase or sodium potassium pump. Tubular maximum for glucose, we have discussed yesterday that the tubular maximum for the glucose, what is Tmax for the glucose or for the other substances. In adult male, the tubular TMG for the adult male is 375 mg per minute, and for the adult female it is 300 mg per minute. And we have discussed the renal threshold. A renal threshold for the glucose is 180V. As we have discussed it yesterday, that whenever there is the glucose level is less than 180, there will be no glucose in the urine. But when the glucose level in the plasma has been increased from this 180 mg per deciliter in the blood, so the blood, when the level of the blood reaches this 180 mg per deciliter, the glucose is not fully reabsorbed and it will appear in the urine. So this is the renal threshold for glucose. Now, what is splay? Splay actually means deviation. Deviation from the normal behavior, from the calculated or the predicted behavior because of any condition. So the splay means deviation. As you know, we have a normal GFR of 120 ml per minute, and the Tmax for glucose is 375 mg per minute in adult male. So the predicted or the expected renal threshold for the glucose, which has been calculated, it should be 300 mg. But we have discussed that actually it is 180 mg per deciliter. So when the renal threshold curves are drawn by using these values, the actual curve deviates from the should be or the predicted or the ideal curves. This type of deviation is called splay. Means if we calculate the renal threshold from the values, it should be 300 mg, but it is 180 mg. Why it is 180 mg? Because of the fact that all the nephrons do not have the same functions, do not have the same filtering or reabsorbing capacities. So because of this difference, this renal threshold for the glucose is 180 mg per deciliter. Look at this diagram. This is glucose reabsorbed, which is mg per minute, and this is plasma glucose. So plasma glucose, when it is, it should be, this is the predicted threshold, that it should be 300, the renal threshold will be 300 mg per deciliter, because, but it is 180. Why it is 180? Just because of this fact that all the nephrons are not the same and they do not function same. The second last one is the reabsorption of amino acids. How amino acids are reabsorbed So amino acids are also reabsorbed completely in the proximal convoluted tubule, and amino acids are reabsorbed actively by the secondary active transport mechanism along with, as sodium is reabsorbed along with that, amino acids are also transported to the cell, and from the cell these are transported to the interstitium, and from the interstitium these are transported to the blood. Reabsorption of bicarbonate. Bicarbonate is reabsorbed actively mostly in the proximal tubule. It is reabsorbed in the form of carbon dioxide. Now, this is the same mechanism we have discussed in the respiratory system, that carbonic acid mechanism. So, bicarbonate is mostly present in the sodium bicarbonate form in the filtrate. Now, we are talking about filtrate. From the glomerulus, when fluid will enter into the Bowman's capsule and the lumen of the tubule, this is filtrate, and in the filtrate, bicarbonate is present in the form of sodium bicarbonate. So this sodium bicarbonate will dissociate and it will convert into sodium and bicarbonate ion in the tubular lumen. In the same lumen, this will be converted into sodium, and sodium is transported alone, and bicarbonate is transported alone. So this bicarbonate ion is now present in the lumen. Sodium, how it is diffused? It is diffused into the tubular cell in exchange of hydrogen. Now, bicarbonate is present, and bicarbonate will combine with the hydrogen. The sodium diffuse into the cell. In exchange of this sodium, hydrogen ion will move into the tube, the tubular lumen. In the tubular lumen, this bicarbonate ion will combine with the hydrogen and it will form carbonic acid. Carbonic acid will dissociate, as it is an unstable compound, so it will dissociate into carbon dioxide and water in the presence of an enzyme, that is carbonic anhydrase, and carbon dioxide and water will then enter into the tubular cell. Look at this diagram. This is sodium bicarbonate, which is present in the tubular lumen. It is dissociated into sodium and bicarbonate. Sodium is moving into the tubular cell in expanse with the movement of hydrogen ion. This hydrogen ion will bind with the bicarbonate ion, forming carbonic acid. Carbonic acid dissociate into carbon dioxide and water. Carbon dioxide will move into the tubular cell. Here it will combine with the water, again forming carbonic acid. Carbonic acid dissociated into bicarbonate ion and hydrogen ion. This hydrogen is again utilized for the movement of the sodium, and this bicarbonate ion from the tubular cell will move into the interstitial fluid. In the interstitial fluid, the sodium will also move into the interstitial fluid by that sodium potassium pump. So this sodium will bind with the bicarbonate, forming again sodium bicarbonate, and sodium bicarbonate then will move to the peritubular capillaries. So in the tubular cell, carbon dioxide combined with water, carbonic acid immediately dissociate to hydrogen and bicarbonate. Bicarbonate then enter the interstitium, and it will combine with the sodium to form sodium bicarbonate. The last topic is tubular secretion. How substances are secreted into the tubular lumen. So tubular secretion is the process by which substances are transported from the blood into the renal tubules, and it is called tubular excretion. In addition to reabsorption, substances are excreted directly from the blood into the lumen from the peritubular capillaries through the tubular epithelial cell. And it was first discovered by the secretion of diphenol red, which was secreted in the renal tubules in experimental condition. These are some other substances which are secreted, such as pyraminohippuric acid, diode rest, 5-hydroxy, indole acetic acid, amino derivatives, and penicillin. Substances which are secreted in different segments. So potassium is secreted by sodium potassium pump in the proximal and distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct. Ammonia is secreted in the proximal convoluted tubule. Hydrogen ion are secreted in the proximal and distal convoluted tubule. And this is very important for the maintenance of acid-base balance in the body. Maximum hydrogen ion secretion occur in the proximal convoluted tubule. Urea is also secreted in the loop of Henle. So this is the whole story about the formation of urine. This urine is formed by the three processes: First is glomerular filtration, selective reabsorption, and tubular secretion. And this is the summary of whole urine formation, which takes place in three stages, three steps, or three processes, as glomerular filtration, which occur in the glomerulus, the corpuscular portion of the nephron. So plasma is filtered in the glomeruli and the substances reach the renal tubules along with the water as filtrate. Then tubular reabsorption, in which 99% of the filtrate is reabsorbed in different segments of the renal tubules, and tubular secretion, in which some substances are transported from the blood to the renal tubules. With all these changes, the filtrate then become urine. So this was all about the formation of urine